Okay, we'll call the meeting to order.
And we start with the informal agenda item. Number eight, informal discussion regarding the REC Hockington Chamberlain Street Way Road Conventional Subdivision Plan.
Good evening. So, do you want me to sit up here? So, Mark, I'm going to set up an easel for you. We're going to do that. Off to here. I know there's people here that are interested in this as well. Yeah, correct. I'm trying to track it over right now. Thank you for taking the time to consulting. Mark Allen, Allen's in here. Paul Maspiani, who's the owner and applicant. We have an official file and application. I think we'll be accepting before you get that notice of intent. Purpose of our request for time tonight is in response to the request of the planning board in order to provide them some input during their public review process. So this piece of property here, you're familiar with, we've been waiting for the paper because we did an AMRAD on the site. We have an approved wetland boundary. Most of the commission were on at the time when this training to review the wetland delineation. At this time, we are proposing a subdivision to the planning board in a conceptual phase, and in order to establish the total lot count for the project, it has to be based on a conventional layout by the Hockington zoning bylaw. So we provided a plan that we have right here. I think you can scan down to one of the subsequent sheets on here. But this plan right here, can you all see that? Is that visible? Am I bringing it closer?
Yeah, you can bring it a little closer.
Okay. So anyways, here's Chamberlain Road, here's Chamberlain Road. Okay. So conventionally, planning board requires under the zoning bylaws require two roads and cul-de-sacs. So when you put them to the two roads all the way through it, you do a lot count based on your concrete area requirements. It has an impact on some resource areas you wish to be interested in. You would have large crossing here in the middle, second crossing here, third crossing here, fourth crossing right way over. So this project here shows that four crossings and potentially small driveway as well. So this plan is the plan that the applicant owner desires to do, but it does show what the yield of the crossing would be under conventional zoning layout. The impacts of these wetlands would be in excess of about 5,000 square feet. But I do believe that under the limited project provisions of Hockington bylaw as well as the Wetland Protection Act, that this project is something that will be bringing for you in the notice of intent, that we will have a basis on which to seek approval for the protection project. All the houses are shown in buffer zone areas, or outside of buffer zone areas, and then the septic systems would all be located outside of for Port Health. So it's a spacious plan that uses up all the property and it creates a plan yield of 35 house lots. So the planning board is requesting that we come for you to solicit your input. And ideally what we would like is a letter from the Conservation Commission. I mean, obviously we're not having a public hearing with an application, so it's not a formal approval or denial of an action. Send the guidance to the Conservation Commission about the reasonableness of this plan. Because the planning board wants to ensure that what we're proposing in order to get the lot count isn't an unreasonable plan. It's something that the Conservation Commission were to use in the notice of intent. It could be something the Commission could act upon and approve, but I do believe the Commission has a discretionary authority to approve this project and limit the project. So what we hope to do is that we'll take this yield plan and create an open space concept plan which minimizes wetland impacts on the property and condenses the lot count in a way that minimizes lot size, frontage along the road, and then creates
get? Never discussed?
Mark, does this coincide with the sheet?
It does. Yeah, that's the alternative.
So this is the overall one that we just
talked about. Yeah, 9,100.
Yeah.
So what sheet should it go to?
6, thank you.
It just simply has the satellite image behind it. Scott's.
Correct, yeah. I don't think I have those, but I got these.
Right. Well, all I'm showing them here, guys, is this map on the aerial photograph. Right? So the idea you can see here or here is the cluster, the work, Wayland Road, and Chamberlain Road. The planning board still requires some type of a through connection, it seems, just to comply with the zoning bylaw. That could potentially be minimized, need some kind of emergency access, trying to get the planning board to require that to be minimized as much as possible. Instead of the smallest amount of width that would be required by the fire department, the planning board is what we want to go to that area where it crosses the wetland at the center of the site. So ultimately, with this plan, if this were to go forward with the planning board, there would only be two wetland crossings. One would be this very small intermittent road, which is about 1,100 square feet. Okay? And then we have the second one in the middle here, and the square footage is to be determined based on the width. But this plan is somewhere in the ballpark of.
What's that middle one going to be marked by itself?
And the middle one would be about 4,500 square feet, though.
If we had the road width at a full.
At a full 50
foot width. Width.
So we would kind of get that in the data as possible.
So the second crossing would be 4,500 feet square feet?
With a full width. Again, we're working on getting that smaller and smaller. We'll hope to come back for you with something that is small that you can get planned with you to go along. So ultimately, what my request to this board is to provide the planning board some feedback. And it's pretty well at issue 11.
You have that right in?
Yeah. And so the request is really is a conventional plan, something that is feasible and could be permitted by the board. I think the answer to that question is yes. I would leave that to you in the discussion. And then perhaps some input from this board, the planning board, to help guide them as they consider approving the open space concept that. Because of having less weapon crossings, maybe more desirable for this sort of potential layout. Those are two big things.
Well, actually, Scott, there are three plans before them now. There's also an emergency access plan that's, I believe, on Don's sheet number either 7 or 8. Nine. That's the third alternative.
Oh, that's this one.
Correct. Yeah. And it's in the application as well.
Okay. This one here is what it would look like, which is the same layout I was wanting to show you, but this would be stubbing these cul-de-sacs and shrinking that crossing up to make an emergency access.
So it'd be less disturbance than 4,500?
Correct.
Okay. We go down to about 3,650.
So going back to the conventional subdivision plan, would there be any wetland disturbance associated with the road coming off of Chamberlain?
No.
So Chamberlain would have to have some improvements along there.
Correct.
And there are some wetlands along it, but we don't think that it would require any further improvement. There's a bump buffer somewhere, and there is one spot where there's a stream that crosses. See, Chamberlain, that little brook right across here. So we measured the width of that, we think the road would be improved. And then on sheet number 3, I'm sort of restricting. You want this sheet back on this one?
Correct. Yeah, so the question was if on the improved, if Chamberlain Road, there may be some additional improvements required to the right one. That's actually going up there. Right. And there are some wetlands that are adjacent to the road.
There's an existing 12-inch corrugated metal pipe. Mark Allen from the Rare Allen Engineering. There's an existing 12-inch corrugated metal pipe that is undersized. We anticipate, based on the fire department's recommendations and the traffic engineer's recommendations, that all of Chamberlain Road, Chamberlain Street, would be confined to 20 feet wide just for rural bypass, and that culvert would need to be replaced. So we don't anticipate any wetlands being altered, but we do anticipate the replication of that culvert.
BBW closing this year? Crossings.
Yeah, you mentioned all layout?
Yeah, because you mentioned two crossing and then five crossing. I mean, the emergency one. You get a number for the for that one.
Yeah, 6460 would be the total out of the conventional layout.
No, that's BBW.
Again, that's not our desired plan. This is simply part of the conceptual layout in order to determine the special permits parameters, the number of lots moving forward. We would only be requesting in future hearings to do two crossings that would be at or below.
And we do understand that the bylaw too is cumulative consideration as well, and there's been other projects and such like that. So, you know, we would tend to do that whole sort of analysis on the application.
Yeah, sure.
The chamber
was
obviously public private, and I think
that
there is public or private.
It is public.
All the way around.
About 850 feet door of the sharp right.
It would be helpful to the people in the audience if everyone could speak up a little bit.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
Okay, any other questions or comments? Okay, so to answer your question regarding whether or not the commission could approve something like this. You know, I would say it's, you know, potentially feasible. This is an informal discussion. Obviously, we don't have a formal permit application before us. So I would say, is it feasible? Potentially, you know, it is feasible. Is it probable that something like this would get approved because of the four crossings and the amount of disturbance? I would say probably not, in terms of probability. Is feasible. The commission obviously advocates for less disturbance of both BBW and buffer zone. So we, I think, speaking for myself and commission members can weigh in on this. We advocate for obviously less disturbance of both the BBW and the buffer zone. So our commission would certainly advocate for version of this project that has less wetland crossings and less disturbance. And certainly, you know, we would also take into account as part of our contemplation of the project what types of mitigation efforts we provided as part of the project. Area that's being set aside under conservation restriction, compensatory wetland replications associated with disturbance, you know, potentially other factors. I know that the Upper Charles Trail Committee was interested in gaining access to a portion of the property, potentially to get continuity for their trail to certain areas of the town they want to go.
There's also a historical commission issue with it on the land?
That I don't know about. Historical commission issues, you know, that's not as important.
Yeah, there's just one issue.
Sure.
Isn't there, I thought there was a regulation through the Army Corps in the 5,000 square feet of disturbance, but we can't approve.
Right, so. So we have the local flag law, we have the Mass Law Protection Act, we have the 411 calls for the DEP and the Army Corps that they call for. All four sets of regulations in local, state, and federal protect wetlands. In each one of those three, 5,000 isn't a cap, but it is a threshold where the standard review increases over So when you have, if you just have a discretionary filling, it is capped at 5,000. But when you have filling that's required for access, and the wetland protection calls it limited crossing garage or something like this, right? So then the commission does have the ability to exceed 5,000 square feet approval under the wetland protection act. You can exceed 5,000 under your Hopkins bylaw. You can exceed 5,000. And the Army Corps of Engineers certainly can exceed 5,000. Maybe you have another threshold and you go over an acre. So it might be something helpful too to mention in the letter. The planning board was asking about this magic 5,000 number, that the commission does have the ability to approve alterations in excess of 5,000 square feet.
And it's discretion.
It is discretion. But the ability exists to issue the permit.
So I don't know that when given that if the planning board is making a decision based on that plan and how many lots can be built, they don't know that we can say that this plan is okay because we have to apply that discretion to this plan and say that we agree that it's limited project.
This was a bylaw, it would be bifurcated. Basically, an application would have to come in just for the roadway, and then if there was, I don't know how much the bench.
35.
So, do you know how many would be jurisdictional? Traditionally, like 30, 20?
Bulk, yeah.
So for all the other, so it's basically, if you guys are looking at the roadway, you're not looking at the lots, because those would come separately too. So just because they build a road doesn't mean they can build all their lots. It has to be on a lot by lot basis. They file for the road and they file for each house lot. As Mike approved, some of them, all of them, none of them, you know, at all. Yeah.
But I do believe this would be use a limited crossing project for. Because the only purpose of these crossings is to create access where no other access is available for.
So just to clarify Don's point, each lot that falls within the commission's jurisdiction would have to come before us and we would review it and either permit it or deny it. Just so everyone knows. And I think, you know, the point that we want to make is, you know, this is something that is potentially permittable. I'm not saying that it is. Is feasible. The 5,000 square foot is discretionary. It's not a right that the developer has. Something that may be approved. So just to make those points clear. Yes.
The Orchard's property is now the tennis court. There were weapon impacts there and they considered from the separate figures, so that's part of the code.
We would evaluate this cumulatively with those impacts, both at the tennis club and in the public development as well.
Any other questions?
Yes.
Yeah. Apparently the commission said three previous files.
Let me answer your second question. We certainly will put a letter together.
Mark, did you want to add anything else to this?
Just one minor point Harrow's point is about the tennis club. The tennis club did not have any BBW alteration as part of their application. Only the Hopkins Views did have BBW. Implications. So the only cumulative effect as far as BBW goes would be the 762 square feet of the use.
There was buffers on the surface.
Correct.
Yes, correct.
Okay, we'll open it to questions or comments from the audience. So we have a few minutes to keep it brief if we can. Yes, ma'am.
I have a couple of questions on the Chamberlain Street improvements. I'm sorry, Carol DeBurr, 47 Chamberlain Street. The culvert that they're referring to is at the end of Chamberlain with the 12-inch pipe. To get the 20 feet that they need, and I brought you a couple of pictures if you want to see, it's rock on the outside with the pipe going through. And to get the 20 feet, you're going edge of rock to edge of rock. So I guess I'm confused. They talked about putting in a concrete things at the end. So I'm not sure how you can do that without there being any wetlands disturbance. And my other question is with regards to a little further along the street, there's a vernal pool. And to get the 20 feet takes them right to the edge where the drop-off is, so there'd be required fill in that section. So again, I think there's impacts there that should be considered in the impact on it.
Okay. He's talking about this water feature here, that's a vernal pool. We walked it the other day, and the stream that you talked about, those would be buffer zone areas for lighting improved change.
We certainly, I mean, we don't have an application in front of us tonight. We don't have anything that we can review. But when it does come before us, this will be areas that.
Okay, one last question for you. It's my understanding that at this point, you have to look at the conventional plan to determine the number of lots. Would that loop road, would that be okay and approvable to you guys as it is? Not the straight through, which is the preferred plan, which is also my preferred plan. But my question is, does that second road that creates the five wetlands crossing on property, does that make that section basically unapprovable by your commission?
It doesn't render it unapprovable. As I said, it's something that potentially or feasibly could be approved, but I think probability is very low that it would be based on the number of crossings and potential impacts to the PBW and the buffer zone that we have. So again, we hold all developers to the same performance standards when they come into town and propose these types of projects. And our commission has a track record of pushing developers to get areas set aside as conserved land under restriction, pushing back on the amount of wetland and DPW alteration that's proposed, and pushing back on the amount of buffer zone disturbance that's proposed. That's something that very consistently we request of all applications that come before us. Yes, ma'am.
Amanda Foshe, 39 Chamberlain. Would you all consider coming down to that area to take a little walk through? I know the planning board did on Saturday, and it was helpful for them to really see what we were all talking about. Would you all consider doing that before you render any decisions?
We would. This is something that we commonly do. When we have an application before us, the hearing's open.
Don Cavity, 14 Whalen Road. I'm a little bit embarrassed by this, but I'm still a little bit puzzled and confused by the process because we're kind of operating on somewhat parallel tracks here. And according to the planning board, they need a determination from this commission that the project is feasible. And so where does it go from here? How do you make a determination that something's feasible when we're just kind of dealing with real general, non-specific plans that have been submitted to you guys? Now, how do you make that determination? What's the next step to help you make that determination that the planning board needs before they can decide whether this qualifies under that open space plan?
So we'll put together this is an informal hearing, so and a lot of the work that we do is actually studying the project, looking at the amount of disturbance that's being proposed, looking at the location of the roadway, the individual lots, those types of things, looking at the alternatives analyses that are presented to us. We have typically our wetland consultant who is hired by the town to peer review the reports and proposals that are submitted to us. We have the town's engineer, Beta Engineering, peer review any type of structural changes, such as the conduit that is being proposed to be improved on the of the roadway at Chamberlain Street, they would look at that. So there's a fairly detailed and lengthy analysis and process that goes along with a process once the application is, once the project is formally opened. What the planning board is looking for us from now is just an opinion as to whether or not the project could potentially be permitted.
Right, and that's what I don't, that's what I struggle with. How do you make that determination that something's feasible when you just went through all the stuff that needs to be done in order to kind of make a determination? I guess I'm just confused as to how you make that, how do you make that call?
It's based on just experience from other developments that we've worked with in town.
But are you submitted with all that engineering work and that analysis that goes to the town's engineer for the peer review and all? Is that done before you make that feasibility determination, or is that done before you make that feasibility determination?
The all the studies and review is done once the application and the project is formally opened. So we don't have the benefit of having that information in front of us now. It's really us taking a look at the project and based on the experience of the commission, looking to see if the proposed project is something that's potentially permittable or is not potentially permittable. So it's somewhat of a chicken and an egg situation.
Yeah, that's what I'm struggling with.
It's not the ideal situation for us. Have the planning board come back to us and say, you know, we need to know if this is something that's feasible.
Right.
Because it does put us in a situation where, you know, we have to make a judgment based on prior experience, which is obviously not ideal. But unfortunately, we have to use our, you know, former project experience and judgment when we're looking at that.
If I can just, one other question. That there is a vernal pool that's referenced kind of by the, where the crossing is going to be. And how does the commission, does that come into the commission's consideration when it's making that determination as to feasibility? And how, what do you guys do to kind of explore the scope or the breadth of that vernal pool to the extent one is there?
The vernal pools, we typically don't allow disturbance within 125 feet of the vernal pool. If there is a situation where there's a roadway that's within that buffer zone of the vernal pool that needs to be it's an improvement to the situation that's currently there, that's something that the commission would evaluate and weigh in on. But again, we don't have a formal application in front of us. So all I can say to you is that, we take our roles in protecting the town's resources very seriously. And we do our best to protect the resources, understanding, obviously that the developer has a right to develop his land, but there are certain guidelines associated with our bylaw and with the State Wetland Protection Act that that they have to adhere to. So
through the chair, if I could, Mark Allen again, that vernal pool which is shown you, that crossing, has been taken into consideration as far as the conventional and open space plans. It has been shown that 125-foot no disturbance has been shown on the plans as a permanent no-touch zone, and that wouldn't be touched either through conventional or open space.
Oh, and so does it get impacted by at all by where the road is? I mean,
no.
Does it get tightened or expanded?
Absolutely not. No, that road crossing would not impact not only the vernal pool, but not anything within 125 feet of the vernal pool, which is the town's bylaw.
Yep, thank you.
So the way this is laid out, this is the way it's laid out, respecting the wetland law, we drawing blocks as much as possible from the wetlands and things like that. This is a plan that respects all the wetlands that are on the property. It only has crossings at the narrow locations, only to access off the property. So this is a plan that respects the wetland law as it stands today.
If I could just expand on that.
Just a couple more questions, we're going to move on because we only have 15 minutes. minutes.
Sure, just a quickly, expanding on Scott's topics. The one thing that we've done in advance of this was a few years back, we went out and we actually, Scott went out and identified all the wetland resources on the property. They were all field located, they were all approved by this commission. So we're not talking about possible wetland impacts. We know the exact wetland impacts for every scenario that we've designed. And through that ANRAD process is what brings us here tonight to talk about more concise numbers moving forward, whether it be conventional or open space. And again, the developer's option preferred is the open space where we would not have to impact as much wetlands and give back half of the land as preserved open space.
No, that's a good point. Thank you for bringing that up. There was a resource area delineation that was conducted. I believe Mr. Goddard confirmed that. When that work was done, the town's consultant went out and confirmed those locations. And the town and the commission were in agreement with that, and that was approved. So those resource areas are specifically known that are associated with the project. So a couple more questions with that.
Margie Wigan, Clyde Cross Street. Just a big picture question. So I appreciate that you're doing due diligence and being very careful in protecting the resources here. My question is, what would it, how many projects have you rejected from developers trying to put a project in on land that they have purchased over time? Because it seems like we work really hard to try to make it work, and then the developer develops the land, and then we're left with a lot of buildings. And then the second question is, what would it take for this not to go through? What would the conditions be that would make it not fly? Conventional.
So to answer your question, your first question, you know, the commission works very hard with the developers to meet common ground. Again, you know, the developer has a right to develop that property. But going back to what I said earlier, you know, this commission is very diligent about, you know, making sure that the resources and the buffer zones are protected and pushed back. And we have a lot of land in town that's set aside for the conservation restriction. We have a track record of, you know, pushing back on buffer zone disturbance. So there's no specific project that has been rejected or denied. There have been a couple cases where the commission has denied a project, but then it's come before us. The developer has appealed it, and not appealed it, but has submitted a request for reconsideration after, you know, pondering on it, and we come back and say, okay, you know, we understand where you're coming from now, we want to work with it. So there have been a few cases like that over the past couple of years. To answer your second question, you know, we don't have a formal application in front of us, so it's very difficult to answer the question, you know, how could a project, or what would cause the project to get denied? You know, there was just, in the commission's view, an excess of proposed EPW, you know, wetland disturbance and buffer zone disturbance. There weren't any concessions from the developer to work with us. And they came before us and said, this is our plan, you know, take it or leave it. And in a situation like that, I think, you know, I feel strongly that the commission would take the position, you know, okay, the project's going to get denied.
Thank you.
Just right here.
This is Jonathan. Susan Weaver, Sanctuary Line. This is like a watershed between two major rivers, the Charles River and the Sudbury, and I wonder if you may have already had information about how this will impact any Sudbury Valley trustees or the Upper Charles River has any interest in preserving this land as a major beginning of both major rivers. You may know all about that. I'm sorry.
Yeah, you know, it is, Hockington itself is in, you know, what we view as a critical watershed area for the Charles River, the Sudbury River. You know, we're blessed with, you know, a lot of natural resources in the town. We don't have an application for us, so we haven't approached anyone to say, would you be interested in acquiring the property? In fact, that's not up to us. If you don't own the property, the town doesn't own it. The developer does. Some entity came before the developer and made him an offer. I can't say how he would respond to that. It's really difficult, I think, to answer. Yes, sir.
I can push anything, just a quick process question. When the formal plan gets submitted, do you guys take a position on the effect of septic and wells on each of these lots and how that actually impacts the wetland, and how much does that weigh in your decision? Just want to understand the process.
We do. Groundwater is one of the resources that the commission is charged with protecting. We look at that as part of the application process. There isn't a specific weight that I can say that we can give to any particular issue or concern that we have. It varies project to project. Okay, one or two more, please.
Last time. I just want to respectfully request that before you send your letter to the planning board, that you go out and look at Chamberlain Street and the vernal pool and what kind of fill would be required, because that's very close to that, as well as the crossing, the culvert crossing. Just so you have a full understanding, I know you spent a lot of time with the delineations on the property, but these are all off the property. There's a huge pond behind the houses that's, 150 feet from, or less than 150 feet from the roadway. I just want to make sure that when you make your statements in the planning board, that you're totally informed as to what exactly the situation
is. I'm the one who actually put the vernal pool signs in on the trail right there. So I'm familiar with the area. Certainly, I'll encourage the commission members to also take a look at it.
Thank you.
Okay, one more question?
No. Okay,
yeah,
I'll take it. On the process again, are you making the determination on feasibility before a formal application is made or after the formal application is made? And I guess I'll throw in a two-parter there. Nitrogen loading risk as it relates to the different, with the whole septic system and the septics on each lot, how does that come into play?
We will look at that. It's something that the engineer will evaluate as part of their analysis. To answer the second question and the first question, we do make a preliminary determination regarding feasibility without a formal application before us. Okay, so we got to move on with the meeting at this point. If anyone has questions, they're welcome to hang out and wait until the end of the meeting, and we have time. Thank you.
Thank you.
doesn't make sense.
Disturbing the...
What you have. We don't want to have.
First time fighting.
Yeah.
Well, hacking away here, I don't want to contaminate. That same name, if you get to it, but a lot of them want the same name, kind of these funny shapes. Okay, number 38. Level golf property, back, 1 foot buffer, limit of work is at 50. 1 foot buffer is here. House, well, septic, driveway, he's outside. 1 foot buffer. So we have grading, grading only at 50 door. Thank you.
favor?
It's up to you.
Yes.
Just two more.
Just one, two, three, four, seven on the back?
Twenty-two, which is house number 32.
Thank you.
No recharge, nothing in the back. 25 foot buffer in yellow here. 10 foot buffer here. The house is outside it. We have a well that's here. A little bit of the ear of the driveway. Grading PIB in the back. Most of the time. Well, the driveway is a little bit wider than typical. It kind of goes back to, he likes side loads.
And the turnaround, that's just preference, right?
As opposed to.
So when you say that the driveways may change, you refer to the proposed change?
Yeah.
The proposed change in the bylaws from 5 feet?
Yeah. With that in mind, you may shrink those a little bit. These are not one.
The 16.
The minimum?
Yes.
That's correct. Because it involves plus two shoulders.
So this is the minimum?
Plus two shoulders.
Was that older circuit? I thought it was like,
it's
a long driveway.
It had to be within, it had to be close to 50 feet of access to the wall. And then at that point, it would
come out. So it's a product
of. Up to 50 feet on the front door. So it's 300 foot driveway, 250 feet of access to the wall. First.
Whatever. Is that where you're proposing the
grading that's going to happen behind the retaining wall.
Yes, you'll have the work, I understand, a little bit of work goes out there, but I would think that, you know, people think maybe like a fence or something, if I was to put it all back there, it's just like this.
Yep, good point. We could move this, probably to the lot line, which is the purple. This is the grading easement, 120, for benefit of 21.
Okay, so they're ready to be on the lot line.
Yeah, it's on the edge of the easement. Yeah, it's on the edge of the easement. I guess the idea would be true, but something to think about is, if it did move it, it's all grading and it's going behind it. Worst case, it would be in the trees, but it would be better demarcation.
It was created under the lot.
Graded all the way out, right? The PID was, you know, that here, on this lot line, here, and this all along there. It's right, maybe something that's out of the lot of it. So just put it, get it to work.
But it doesn't have to be long.
It doesn't have to be long. It has to sort of slope it to that grade.
Yeah, because then on the buff zone, the commission has the classification of temporary disturbance, so instead of putting loam and seed, you can just put a conservation, you know, seed mix down and, you know, like a wire, you know, turn it into turf grass. So you talked about that, any of that?
We could do that for this part here, yep, right here, and that little rectangle.
Steve, we put the other ones that would be in with the, where you had to get access to do the wetland replication area?
Yeah.
Yeah, so you're going to, it was areas that had been disturbed, and then they were going to restore some of the area that was cleared to get access for the.
Yeah, we haven't talked about that one yet, but we've seen the picture.
I think you called that out with the revision, right? The size plan, you were able to show that, yeah, it was disturbed, but then you're going to restore it?
Yep, we have a note on that.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, yeah.
So you can make the same change to the.
That one? 21? Yep. We can do this rectangle there. Put that there and keep the PID, the hay there, and then make it spot.
Yeah, get your grades. Yeah, get the grades you need, and then just we'll see with the. See.
We can make that change. We'll make sure that it's a condition.
Yeah, I mean, you should be able to give us a revised. And subject to the option, you guys have. We just condition the eyes plan.
So while you're there, there's a reason for the quarter.
I'm sorry?
Is there a reason for the quarter?
This?
Yeah,
that's an honest request. This is the existing retention basin. And a little bit of work is probably here now in order to construct that. So he was just trying to. And then this, blend this to that, to make that. You can see if we had flipped that off and sort of truncated that a little bit. We just wanted to kind of manicure this all the way down the pond. Be able to control it. That was the preference all the way there.
To the boulder or the fire?
No, to Cannon Rocks. Because it's the script now. It's probably the script.
So he's using it for access to
the. Oh, it's part of the line, so he was just.
Basically,
just one. He promotes it.
The people have to, right? You don't want trees and shrubs in that area, right? Because it's a detention basin.
It's a side slope for the basin. Yes.
Whatever they sold.
The homeowners association?
Homeowners association.
Part of the stormwater operation maintenance plan, right?
So beyond that total, it's all grass and renewables?
Yep, it's all grass.
So would it be something to get me go around? Like for somebody else who would be maintaining that basin, are they not gonna?
I guess if the homeowners association hires them to cut. Yeah.
They would cut the bush and save the place, the bush and the IP. And it won't be as long as probably as often. So this homeowner would be responsible for that. And then the homeowners cut.
Creating a barrier between the homeowner and the homeowners association contract, but what about the contract that's just even up? Yeah, I think that saying around the top to meet the line of demarcation with that, would you hire Joe Schmuck? Up on the top, right, towards, because it's all within the same lot.
Yes, yes.
So make it a heavy continue that way so that that landscape, correct, just hire somebody who goes out and just goes crazy. And it'll be like a line up. Yeah, or somewhere to pick that wetland which continues out this way. That's what she's saying, right? I'm saying more.
That's probably just part of the grass. So maybe on trees.
You're right, we've got to spend the homeowners association, there's landscape for that, somebody who's down line and they're not looking at this.
So that'd be a special condition?
Yep. Do that, since the guidance there.
Sure.
So even though that's, the basin is on this lot,
it's still a drainage easement, right?
All of this ground is a drainage easement, it's section P14, which means it goes all the way around that. Comes across to the that's the easement. We're all even for that. Homeowners take that way.
But I also prevent the homeowner from there being like, this is my property and I'll fill that in.
Okay, it's a good catch. Any other questions?
So we're going to get a revision to clarify.
Revision our conditions for wild seed next year.
I heard that.
And guidance along this northern boundary between the basin and the wetland.
Okay, so it's on the property line, yeah, what is the line utilizing as the giant line? Is it the red line?
Yeah. Yes.
So that's the property line?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Can't boundary. Get 12 down here? It's like a cave in here. I don't know what you guys are saying, you know, right here.
Can we kind of work out in the field too? Work out in the field with approval of the waiver. It's just it's kind of
hard. Dave would have to locate. Dave, yeah, well, you guys have to survey locate.
Why don't we have that discussion? Because we choose the PIB. Why don't we choose that? Can we make it a special condition that we'll walk it and determine where the giants be built? And the reason is kind of the guys.
Yeah, because then, you know, basically, if it's a property line, you'd want to have them on posts, not on trees. That would be too random. You'd want to just serve, usually if it's a straight line, it's usually like every, if it's a straight line, it's like every 30 feet, 50 feet, you have a medallion. But when you're going on a curve, if you're going around like that, you might have one here, taking the curve. When you start with a straight line, which is usually like, that would be 30, 50 feet fine as long as it's, trying to
show. But when you see it, it's straight.
Right.
And the bottom slope is going to that.
Exactly. So I was thinking, if you're doing medallions, you might have one close and one to work, one in the middle, one in the end, and that would sort of help it,
It'll be the term area field.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
And if we do it by condition or determine the field, the aspect will show have a location.
Yeah, we'll pick it up. Yes.
Okay. Motion to close and approve. With the special conditions as discussed, and then use your revised plan, obviously.
Okay.
I'm just highlighting that.
Yep. Okay. So moved.
And a second. All in favor?
Aye.
And opposed?
Good time for one more?
Yep.
That's the one that's failed last. Three, wetland here, ropes cable area here, 50 feet based on the replication area is in here. The 25 is here, based on the replication. And 100 foot buffer is here. System, drive, house, well, PIB, and I'm going to head over here. Lots of the all over here. We do, this is the lot, only lot tonight with recharge. So I'll have the house number 25.
That's three.
Three is, yep.
Questions or comments from the commission?
Is it a unanimous decision?
Some space down here.
Jack's zero, lines are excited.
Motion to close and approve with the standard conditions.
So.
All favor? Aye, it's proposed.
Ready to say something to me?
Okay.
You did, yeah.
Yeah.
Seven, yeah.
Okay, Hockington DPW, East Main Street, the notice of intent for our new sidewalk.
I know, this one's a continuation, correct?
Sidewalk page.
Yep, I got the electron.
Great, thanks.
You just didn't write it down, sorry, continuation, sorry. Yep, yep. The way we wrote it on the agenda, it looks like it's a new one because it doesn't say continued, but it was the
old one. Okay, so.
That's okay. So we met the two folks last time. There was a particular field issue after the meeting. My staff and Don, someone from Bader, actually walked the site from the folks.
Phil Paradis.
Yes. And came up with a PRP letter. We addressed comments that we got, and we received a second peer review letter on the 20th from Beta. Pretty much all but two of the comments that they had initially were addressed. There was just two comments that they still had. One had to do with providing the type of what they were calling a sewer structure. So you used it on
the sidewalk. The other ones?
Yeah, for the sort of water filtering facility, the sidewalk.
West Main?
Yes, sorry,
East Main.
Yes. So we would use the same things that are on West Main, on East Main. The only question we had was that there's a low point at station 3720.
I think what he was thinking is this is the low point. So you keep with the catch basin down.
Yes.
Right? So then what he was thinking with the amount of sediment, you know, if the DPW between didn't clean the top of the catch basin. And you had a storm event, if it was a bad place to have water puddle up on the road. So I think off to the side, you have one of those sluices just in case the water was pooling up and not getting to the catch basin as a backup, you know, just because it seemed like, I think you said, this is a bad spot. And if somehow that got covered up, We have just, and then, you know, then the water would go off the culvert. We had a place to drop it. That's what, I think those were his comments.
And that's, that we can certainly add it in again, the same type of structure that we would be, we would add in as we did on West Main Street. We have that concrete slab that sat, and the sidewalk has a gap.
Yes.
Seasonally, the house has some sort of ground and insulation. That's what they're looking for.
Because I think there's such a long leg between catch bases. You know what I mean? That, you know, it's like under, you know, there was so much length of road. I think that's what the concern was. It would all come down here. You might be carrying a lot of sediment, leaves, whatnot, you know? So I think we were thinking, geez.
And we don't have a problem. We kind of, I just kind of looked at it.
That was the kind of rationale, but I think we're just throwing out, I think he's throwing it out to, I forget who, from your office, Matt, you know? So we were chewing a lot as we walked the whole length, you know? And I think when he, you know, started looking at it, everything, because we'd asked for other information, I think that's what's like, oh, geez, in that spot, what if we, I think it came after his wife, like, oh, you know, what if that happened? What do we have to back up?
And we can certainly add that.
All right.
I don't think that would be an issue.
All right, great.
So those are the two outstanding items.
I think,
well, the other outstanding one was, and he made the comment about that on the north side of East Main Street, he made the comment about, I guess this sedimentation and that's on.
Oh, yeah, the wetland, yeah. Scale, would you be able to, you know, try and clean out that area where it's got?
Well, I guess I'd kind of close that back at you and me. We're not disturbing the wetland.
No.
We're right up with the tool. But I mean, to take sediment that's already existing in the wetland.
Yeah, I mean, I wonder if it would be like mitigation for, you know, trying to, for the work, because you're filling the wetland, you know, out of the project. And well, we're just looking just as mitigation, can we, you know, the area that's been impacted, would be able to try and move somewhere. This is just like a big wash.
Who's that on this town, right? So, Western Hershey's Rest of the
Yeah, no, I think
it's right. No, it's really on fire.
I thought we were looking at where it hit the shoulder.
Well, that's, I guess that's one of the questions I have. It says, removing where possible in wetland areas.
Yeah, because the wetland was right up to us. When we were going down on the left hand side, the wetland was right up tight against the road. And that's where, like, you can see it was the low point, and we were just thinking right there.
I mean, if it's right off the edge of the road,
exactly.
Like, before you actually hit the wetland line, I know that there is a little bit of, there's a couple of feet, look at the plan, there is a couple of feet from the edge of the road that changes now.
Right.
And where the wetland is actually is, it's probably 6-7 feet on me. I guess we should certainly remove whatever is there before we use the sidewalk.
Yeah.
So you just read to me that there's a set of times in the wetland. It's like, if it is, then,
yeah. But I was thinking,
I wouldn't want to go with the weather, but we're going to kind of sort of go against what
you're. Well, we're just trying to mitigate for, you know, all the crap that was in the weather within the measure, too, you know. Why just, you know, look at it and say, oh, okay, that sucks.
You know,
it was one section, yeah. Where,
is it from all that flooding from, was that last year?
Yeah, and it also looked like the plow went off the road and
pushed it
and sliced into the earth, because basically it was like you had all this mounded sediment acting as a berm, protecting the wetland, and the plow came through and went off and sliced into it. And then you'd have an area with a pavement would want to send all the water, but they sliced into it before, so it sliced into the berm, and instead of hitting where it should be all collected, where they were going to put improvements like riprap, it was before that, so all the water that was coming from this street was not hitting that area, it was sliding in, so we're like, could we just take that crap out, fix it, you know, so yeah, regrade it, so to make the improvement where it gets sliced in, and then because you're going to make the riprap improvements where the pavement sort of carries it where it wants to carry. So it was just that area, we're like, oh, wow, look at this, this place is a mess, you know? I think that's, I assume that's what Phil was talking about, because we were saying, geez, can we just, you know, bring all that fill back so it'll be a berm again, where they sliced into it. I might have took some pictures of the area, too. I can email it to
that's
you.
That's something that you guys can do, right?
Yeah, like I said, if we're not actually physically getting into the wetland, there's sediment from runoff, sediment from whatever, stormfall, and it just happens, because it is a low point there now.
Yeah, and basically, it was right, you know, where the pavement ended, the wetland was right there.
Right.
You know what I mean? That's what I'm saying, yeah. It was basically...
Because I mean, you construct that area and just install the sidewalk, so yes. I think that by doing the work, we're going to be getting rid of the sediment anyway.
And it might have been because then you got to cross over, you got to cross over and get onto the southern side.
Yes.
It might have been a little beyond because then you guys said we'll make improvements on where the pavement flares, and then you put some crushed stone. I think that was part of the mitigation. Mm-hmm. So we're like, oh, okay, this area is going to get refurbished, and that's what we said. Well, you're going to refurbish this, but if we leave this alone where they sliced in, instead of it's never going to make it there, it's still going to wash off. So that's where we're like, could we fix that berm and then all the trap that went in, just basically taking the trap and utilizing it to
crap.
Yeah, take it to crap.
Yeah, that's a terminal.
Yeah, you know, and putting it back in for the berm so the water gets directed down into the refurbished sluice.
That doesn't seem open.
No, it seemed feeling. I think that's what we use right now.
And then we can modify the plans on the other structure.
Yes.
Yes.
And then you can vote on this. We can continue on resubmittal of the plans, people by data.
Oh, yeah, for the. Yeah.
Okay.
No, I don't think they
can do
that. No. Yeah, this is details. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Questions or comments? All right. Make a motion to close and approve the notice of intent with the conditions as discussed and pending submittal of revised plans showing the. Updated or revised structures as discussed.
I'll make a motion.
And second?
Second.
All in favor? Aye. And opposed? Okay. Careful when you step back. Good stuff.
All right, thank you. All right, thank you all.
Thank you. Bartlett, 26 Clinton Street. This is a notice of intent to raise the septic and to install a sewer utility line.
It's when you got to read it.
Huffington Conservation Commission held a public hearing on April 24th, 2017 at 7:30 p.m. at Huffington High School, 980 Row. Your old person is interested in the notice of intent filed by Kathy Bartlett to remove a septic tank and install a sewer line with associated site work, 26 Clinton Street, Assessors Map R14, Block 9, Lot B.
Evening. Joe Markman, I'm here on behalf of Kathy Wayne Bartlett. They own number 26 Clinton Street. That is that red rambling farmhouse in the daycare. The backyard is that freshwater pond that sits out to the west of the home. This is the lot here. That is the resource area associated, the bank associated with the pond, the barn, and the home. They have a failed septic system up here to the north side. They are part of an agreement with Legacy Farms to tie into that wastewater treatment plant on the east side of Clinton Street. But what we are proposing to do is to cut that pipe from the house to the septic tank and make a connection across Clinton Street to the existing main on the eastern side. The issue we have is that the tank, to satisfy the water health, needs to be raised, crushed, fill the sand, pumped, crushed, fill the sand. And that is the bulk of the work inside the buffer zone. You can see the yellow here, I highlight that. That is the area that we're talking about. So we've got a small area there, where we cut the pipe, we'll leave that in place, we'll fill the tank, and we'll make the connection with a 6-inch pipe easterly to the main.
So the crushed stone stuff is to fill the tank?
Right. Yeah. Yeah, that's all we need to do, satisfy water health. We'll leave the piping in place, whatever is out here. Whatever state it's in, we'll leave that alone. Just fill the tank. Regrade the area that we'll see.
All right, pretty straightforward. Bob, any comments, concerns?
No, there's no other wetland impact.
Okay, questions or comments from the commission? Can get a motion to close or approve the notice of intent as discussed with standard conditions.
So
and a second, please. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And opposed? So the graduating class transitioned from diapers to flushing the toilet?
Yeah. Put a little burn on the system, yeah.
Thank you. Motion to close and approve the, to take that back, can I get a motion to issue a negative determination of applicability for the RDA?
It's gonna be one of these both. It'll be a negative and a positive. Yeah. We're gonna prove the delineation is accurate, and then we're going to note that all the work is proposed outside the commission's jurisdiction. So it's one of those rare ones where we list off both.
Gotcha, okay. So positive regarding the delineation and negative determination with regard to the site activity outside the buffer zone. And the second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
And opposed?
Did you think you'd be able to bring that up?
I did.
Okay.
Yep.
Because
Because they were in a hurry because it's a septic.
Yeah.
What we did was we quickly brought up.
Okay. We don't need to.
Let me pass them around for the signatures.
And I'll go around for it.
Okay.
Yeah, the document's not ready. We're just on the signature.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, they asked for us to do a signature page in case you guys approved. Just because it's a septic zone, they want to
get it over. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Yeah,
okay. Mr. Chirico.
This is the work session. Good evening. Mr. Chirico. 45 Grant Street. It's a vacant lot. We've had approval for a number of years. Another extension, please. At this point, the septic system is in, the well is in, the driveway is in, not paved, but it's gravel. And the erosion controls have come down on this side. I haven't done any work here in years, probably 5 years, 6 years, maybe even longer.
So, 2 year extension request.
Basically, you started the project, you got the septic, the well, the driveway in, right? The house is outside of that jurisdiction.
Right.
So, what would be left in that jurisdiction?
Paving the driveway.
Paving the driveway, that's it. So, that's the only thing outstanding.
Is this the lot that had like all the glass fragments and everything in there?
No, that's the one I was asking about. Looks like a big crease up there.
Yeah.
It's across the street.
Oh.
Right, this one, is this on the southern?
This is on the southerly side.
Yeah.
On the southerly
side. I've got something with you.
I've got a stump in the driveway so nobody can get in there. That would drag that out once we've got a stump before we go.
Why did you have a drag?
Because I own it.
Okay, motion to close, just a motion to approve the 2 year extension on the permit.
3 year.
All right, 3 year.
3 year.
Yeah, you can do it 3 year.
So moved.
Thank you.
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
All in favor?
All right.
And opposed?
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you.
So he started basically, he kept these trees here.
Yeah.
started firing off those trees.
Right, and but then he re- and so
and then, yeah, then he jumped down off his truck and said, "I better call." So, I mean, you did.
Right,
but you know, so, I, that's why I had Huffington man because I figured he'd know the rules.
Right, but I think he was just thinking there's wetlands out back, but right. Also there's land that you don't own on the side, you know, someone else.
Correct.
You know.
Yeah.
So basically, the wetland comes up along the side too. So you've got you would have a 100 buffer zone from the wetlands to the rear of the property coming this way, and then you'd have on the side of your house, you'd have another 100-foot buffer zone. So it's probably, if you're standing looking at your house, probably the front left-hand side, probably that last tree that he's got marked,
yeah,
is probably right about where the 100-foot buffer zone is, you know? So in essence, the trees that he cut were greater than 50 feet away, and then
I give him credit for at least cutting them around.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, so I mean, basically, I could tell from one stump, you know, you got some rot right here, you know.
And half the tree was like busted off.
Right, so I mean, all we can look at is the stumps, yes. You know, so.
The others are like sumac or some other kind of thing, because I could be just cleaning up on cut poison ivy.
Yeah, yeah.
So yeah, yes.
So basically, there was, he's marked trees that are obviously within 0-50 feet. They're along the perimeter.
Yeah, just like along the yard itself, right on the perimeter.
Right. And then, so the tree cutting that happened was outside the 50, so basically, I think if you were going to then entertain the trees that are inside, it would be a minor project exemption, because typically you'd be looking for trees from, you know, 50 out, you know? So I would think you'd probably be looking for, you know, an RDA application to look at his proposal to cut the trees.
What amount are we on them?
Like seven. They're all old ash trees rotting down at the bottom and covered with poison oak or sumac or something. You know, I'm scared to walk it back up.
Yeah.
So I was just looking at, you know, cutting down, cleaning up the yard, because I'm kind of an angry freak and I like to make it manicured and beautiful.
So he's marked the trees here with paint.
Yeah.
This one had, you know, you can sort of see the hardwood there, but everything else, you know, I didn't see a lot of insect damage. And obviously it hasn't leaked, you know,
you see all the debris from, like, I mean, I just bought the house in December. Somebody rebuilt the whole thing, did all the landscaping, but it looks like they pushed a lot of garbage into the area. Right. There's some old gutters and stuff pushed right underneath that debris. And I'm just trying to clean the playground.
Yeah, so you'd have kind of a lawn area here, and then it was wild. You'd see some of the stumps right here. So they were starting close to the road.
Yeah,
and
there on this area. Like, if you're putting a couple of spruce trees to hide my neighbor's house, because it's a little on site.
So, and you can see the stumps there.
Yeah.
And basically, you probably, now, I don't know how to survey, but you're probably talking 100 feet right about here, so.
So I basically can't kind of.
Well, you'd need permission,
okay.
You know, so, I mean,
yeah.
So the commission would have to review that. And then I also noticed that it looked like you might have did some driveway work.
The driveway was as is when I bought the house.
Okay.
Other than those rocks right there, that was a lot of washout, so I stacked those rocks.
See, that's what, so it looks like you put in a small retaining wall and probably put in some fill there.
Yeah.
So that's within the commission's jurisdiction too.
Okay.
So you would have needed a permit for that work as well. So I would think the commission would, you know, if you're gonna do a filing after the fact, you'd have to, you know, look, hey, I put in a retaining wall and did some driveway work. I think you probably had a gravel driveway here, right? And then did you put the blacktop in?
No.
The blacktop was already in?
I did that, yeah.
All right.
It was all done. And it was just the way it was washing down. The road water washes down, comes right down the driveway where the truck is, and just ruts it all up.
Yeah.
So it was washing the driveway away, basically.
Right. Okay.
So, I'm ignorant to this, because I had no idea I needed to ask permission to do all this.
Yeah, it's something that's permittable. We just need to formal application.
Okay.
That's not necessarily an after the fact.
Yep.
Application submittal, take a look at the trees you want to remove.
Okay.
And probably allow you to do that through the request. All the plans put in place just to replace it.
Sure.
A lot of times, if you get a live healthy tree that's huge, you know, that you're concerned about, if you want it. Usually it would be a swap, like, okay, can I take up a large towering tree, put in a small understory tree or a bunch of shrubs,
I love vegetation. I just, in the front of the house, if you can get back to that one, there's two giant oaks. I'd love to cut those down just for the fact that, like, if I could pave in the front of the house and put some kind of a guardrail or something there, because, I mean, the plows come by and come right over half my lawn when they plowed this one. You know, like, until they found out where the road was. They're pretty much straight at 2 feet.
Yeah, they have these two marked as well?
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah, eventually I thought I could put a shed there or something, but I found out now I cannot do that. So my other idea is to put a 12-by-12 shed right at the end of the driveway where I put that gravel.
Yeah, see, those are the two trees you got right in front. And I was just sort of guessing from, there was an old stub of a wetland flag on the side yard, not out back.
Okay.
So I just grabbed the tape from that stub and ran up to 100 here. So those two trees are pretty much within the jurisdiction too, you know. So
right.
You get two, you would have 200-foot buffer zones, you know.
Yeah, it's just trying to cut, you know, do it with a nice clean slate so I can start doing my head. That's what I do before.
So I think, basically, it would be, it looks like it would all be buffer zone where the driveway and freeway. So, guess we'll probably entertain it as a determination of capability application.
Yeah, I would love to have it come out. Yeah, take a good look at it, show me what I can do and what I can't.
Probably have you come in the office and walk through the application process, because it's most of it's state forms and it's pretty confusing. So, we'll do a tabletop and then if I can get some base plans that you can use to then draw in.
Sure.
That is where the driveway, these are the trees. You can sort of walk through that.
Great.
All right.
Okay. Another question is, would I ever be able to put an addition on that house eventually, like a master bedroom on the side?
That
seemed like a lot of land.
And then that might, you know, if you weren't meeting the residential 50-foot setback, the commission might entertain that as a notice of intent. But if your addition was probably outside the 50-foot meeting the setbacks, and in the disturbed area, which is the lawn area, the commission would probably entertain that as an RDA. So, and an RDA application is good for 3 years, you know. So once you're submitting this RDA anyways, you might want to just draw in, this is where I'd like to put an addition. It would be good for 3 years if you didn't have, you know, if you're like, well, I did the driveway, I did the tree work, but, you know, if you wanted to say, geez, I might be able to get the addition in the next 3 years, why not apply for it now, you know? And then if you didn't, you could just say, all right, well, I'll apply when I can do it down the road, right? You know? But
yeah,
the term is good for 3 years, you know? So if you think and you're in that 3-year window,
sure.
Why wouldn't you apply for it now?
Oh, I do it right now.
Yeah, you know, and then they can look at it and give you, and then they give you feedback on what they think. I'll teach them to sit down.
Yes.
Yeah.
Process for determination of that.
Yes, different types of applications. It's minor permit applications and more major. Right now we're talking about minor, but it's still confusing as heck. It's written by the state, you know, so I can't tell you, like, what is this? So, all right,
sounds good. What were you thinking?
Garrett, and I'll thank you.
Okay.
All right.
If I see a white dog,
a white dog, a black box.
Oh,
can't hear very well.
No. Yeah, from up the street, runs down the hill.
Well, she's on the other street. But yes, probably.
I've seen that dog. Yeah,
except the little one.
This guy
grows
the. Good to see. Yeah.
She's nice.
All right.
She flanders. She can't hear anything.
Oh, no, she's dead.
That's right.
Oh, yeah.
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 No,
next time I'll bring class and try.
I don't think you guys are
there. Where do you go?
Oh, no, you
Bellingham.
Don't
oh, okay.
Yeah. I'm born and bred Bellingham. We got up in the mountains a couple of years ago. I'm just going to live by a lake station.
Okay.
And then so I can vote.
So you have like a store?
I do.
Yeah, okay.
I've been down there almost 20 years.
What's it called?
And all these fine jobs.
Yeah, that's the last one.
Yeah, sure.
Basically, this is what I sent to Don today.
I'm going to add it here.
I do have some hard copies. I don't know if I did enough for everyone.
They can have, as long as Don gets them.
You saw in your mom's house?
No, but somebody, it is somebody's mom's house. Right. So I'm a realtor with Cavalier Real Estate. I'm the owner of this property, 8 Fruit Street. And my trade name is Sal Mom's House. So I help seniors and families transition. This is actually a joint venture with people who previously owned the property. That's just some background on it. But basically, the property at 8 Fruit Street is a couple more of these.
And I got the hot copies. We were able to pull the hot copies.
It's under agreement to be sold, and the next door neighbor also has their home on the market. Currently, we share a driveway. That's the issue. It's not an issue so much as a repair.
On the right hand side.
Yes, yes. Our request is to repair the existing. Get guidance from the committee on what would be necessary, if anything, to repair the existing hardtop because it's a severe hump in the middle. There's two ruts with a hump in the middle. Smaller cars, bottom out of it, actually driving up the driveway and could get crushed. I've got some pictures of it actually here too. We've had a proposal to from a contractor his suggestion was rather than put blacktop back there, which could heave again with the frost, that he have a solution that's described on the letter, where we put a new apron, as he called it, from the road to a row of cobblestones. From the cobblestones to over the worst area where the hump is, he's proposing we put bluestone and leave it open so that it won't heave and create the same problem over again. Then another row of cobblestones, and then new paving up to the split. Because when the split forward is in good shape. So the reason I'm here, I guess, is that because we wanted to make sure Don's been out of the property to advise me on other matters. There's a wetland nearby, and we wanted to make sure whatever we did was in compliance with the rules. So we're wondering if it's something that, since it's a repair, is something that we can just go forward with, or if in fact we need some sort of more formal approval.
If you look at the Board of Health plan that he's provided, with the driveway highlighted in yellow, you notice you got a finger wetland close to the road, right near it. Mm-hmm. So I guess one of the questions I had, they were saying over the phone, I just got this stuff today and haven't had a chance to really look at it, but when he was talking, so you've got a paved driveway through here, and then they were talking about ripping it up and putting gravel down. I know in the past, the commission's had issues with gravel driveways because when they run out, how you fix it is you bring in more fill, more gravel, and just grade it out. And basically, a lot of the gravel just ends up in the wetlands. So I guess the question was, would the commission consider this a maintenance project? Or if you take, basically, the blacktop is acting as the, it's acting like the turf grass, acting like the mulch. It's keeping the dirt, from being exposed and washing into the wetland. It's, in essence, the erosion control factor. But if you could present, that's what I was wondering, would the commission consider this? We've never had anything like this before where we're going to take a blacktop, and normally it's like we're just going to rip it up and put down new. But if you're going to rip this up and have gravel exposed. But now you're saying, but then you said it's going to be cobblestone or?
Just as a buffer between the blacktop and the gravel, so that there's, the delineated mark and basically that's the solution.
So I guess with the committee, because as an exempt request, you wouldn't be able to condition anything, so I didn't know if you guys were okay, if you'd have enough information to look at this as an exemption request, or the question would be, would you need to ask for an application so you could condition whatever they're proposing.
So how long is the bluestone section of the driveway that's supposed
to? Is it the whole yellow?
No. It's really the middle of that yellow. The whole yellow
yellow, the whole yellow is the entire driveway through the split. It's about, I would say, approximately a third, kind of starting where that bend is and ending a little further down.
So if you draw it in, could you show them?
Yeah.
Why are you having to ask a question? This isn't, there's no pipe under the driveway, that's causing.
I haven't seen one.
Well, causing the heat, right?
No.
So why not dig out the hump, as you call it, and then rebuild the driveway by properly compacting the base and then repaving it? That's why I do this.
Well, because it is a fairly wet area, the thought from the contractor, I'm not a contractor, was that it's probably going to freeze and heat again.
My guess is it was not compacted. That's why it's heated. So if it's compacted properly, it's not going to heat. Otherwise, we have roads, all the roads heated. So.
Yeah, and if they didn't build a good base, if they didn't put down good gravel, if they just put it on top of the existing, you know, arrived, you know, like organic.
You don't strip off the unsuitable construction material, organic soils and so forth. And you lay your base on top of it, it's never going to be. Not going to be right, it's going to be safe and all that. So if you dig that out and then compact it properly and repave it instead of the stone and the open stone and sand and mush. And that'll get right out.
And in either case, do you need a pipe to accommodate the water?
No,
there's no stream channel. You just need to.
I mean, the surface water?
Yeah.
That's just because it's probably not graded correctly. I don't know if it's a crown, a driveway.
Well, that's what it is. So you can call it a crown instead of a hump.
Sure.
Yeah, it's going lengthwise. Oh,
so it's in the center.
It's in the center, well, lengthwise in the whole driveway. It's right. The hump, as I call it. So picture you're going down the road. There's ruts on either side where your tires go.
Right.
And for a length of 40, 50 feet, you could potentially be hitting this hump in the middle.
Yeah, so the driver's like this, you know. You got to. Where the tires go, and it goes up, and it goes.
One of the pictures I put a straight board across what I call a hump in a tape measure. You can see it's about a 4-inch drop. You know, the top left picture shows that hump the best.
Yeah.
But then the two on the bottom is an attempt to show the depth of it. Because if you put a straight edge across it, which is that bottom left one, you know, you can see that there's a daylight underneath. You know, it's touching the middle where the hump is, and there's daylight on the right and left where the tires go. But on the top, you can see that's a pretty good length. So this gentleman, and I'm not a contractor, but he said, you know, this is what I would recommend because, you know, as it goes up and down, it's going to just settle right back in there. And, you know, it's...
Yeah, so I would say that just given the, you know, the length of the driveway and the work that needs to be done and the proximity of the wetland, and something that if you're gonna pull all that pavement up, recompact it, and then put bluestone down, you would want to condition that so that there's something that's gonna prevent the gravel from eroding out and getting washed into the wetland. Whether it's, you know, some type of riprap on the sides of the driveways or cobblestones on the sides to prevent the water from eroding off the gravel. Some type of burn. So when you're saying time is of the essence here, and what's your time frame?
Well, my property is closing on May 23rd. The new owners would rather have this done before they'd rather not deal with it. Deal with the having to share the cost with the neighbor. So if replacement's easier, then we would just, I guess, go with that suggestion and just pay it. But I figured, you know, how far can the gravel really wash? It's 3/4 inch. It's not going to go very far.
Well, it's the fines. I mean, it's not a uniformly graded stone, right? It's pressure on a backpack. So it has fines in it, it has stone. Then it's fine material. It's a fine material that washes out there. And then that creates another loss of rust.
Then it gets into a situation where you come back every couple of years to fill in the holes, fill in the potholes, and then you just get this continuing chronic situation of filled and washing to the wetland. You've got it So I guess the options are, if you wanted to go with this as proposed, we need to, I think an RDA would be the appropriate procedure. Or well, request for determination of applicability. Send me a formal permit request to put in for the commission. If you just want to remove the asphalt, compact it, and then repave it, I think that's something that we could probably approve as a minor project exemption. That's something that you could do right away. Whereas with the RDA, we're going to come before us again.
I see. Well, then let's go that approach because, I'm really kind of a pragmatist to this. I want a solution so that everybody's happy, and I don't want to prolong the process. So I'm to understand that if I just replace the existing asphalt and grade it properly, compact it, grade it.
Yeah, if you take it up, and if you look underneath, and you're like, geez, this isn't even good gravel, if you wanted to excavate down to take off whatever's cold, you don't want to put new blacktop on crap. I love that word tonight. And you're like, we're just gonna take out the poor undersoil and put in some nice gravel so we'd have a nice base for our for our binder coat and our top coat of asphalt. So hopefully you'll avoid frosties.
I'll leave up to the contractor. If he puts it an inch or two wide, that's not a big deal, right?
If you were making it wider or getting it closer to the wetland, we're gonna change the location of it, As long as you rip up the existing blacktop, dig down whatever you need, haul off all the bad stuff, bring in the good stuff, lay it out, compact it, put in your new blacktop on the same spot, same footprint. Yeah. That's maintaining the existing driveway.
All right, well, that works for me. So thank you for your consideration and your time. We'll go that solution. Subject to the neighbors.
Oh yeah, and typically
the neighbors have to agree with me because we're sharing.
And then you'd have erosion controls along the edge.
Both sides, right?
Well, you wouldn't need an upgrading because the wetlands are on one side. Just to why you're ripping up the blacktop, and if you're digging down.
Installed before.
You put a limit of erosion controls right along the edge of the limit of work, the driveway, just so before in between ripping up the old blacktop, before you get the new blacktop down, all that exposed soil.
Right.
So if you get a thunderstorm, it doesn't all wash into the wetland. It took us 2 weeks to, we ripped up the old blacktop, but it took us 2 weeks to put the new one in. We had three thunderstorms. Yep. So as long as you have erosion controls along the edge of the,
I'll make sure the contractor does that, and he has to pull his own permits out of the map. It's probably permit.
With the DPW, you'd need, if they've already got it existing, just to repave it? Okay, so DPW again? All right.
You gotta do the dig save at least.
You mentioned that.
I can take
these on using a shared light basis model.
Okay.
So it gets shut down.
Very good.
So okay. I can write you a letter to that effect.
That would be great.
Everything I was just talking about.
Okay. All right.
Thank you. Thanks for the work you do.
There was an item for the neighbors, by the way. I talked to them. They had an item to be approved tonight.
We're trying to get to that right now. It's one of the documents they got to sign.
They couldn't make it tonight, so I'm sure they'd rather see that.
Just watch your step behind.
Possible. Thank you. I'm just what that's worth. Thank you.
Okay.
So going to that effect. Segueing into what he just said, we've got a six Fruit Street. It's called 6 and 8 shared driveway. There was a certificate of compliance issued way back in the day. The original got lost, so they had to record it. So there's a signature page going around, so we can get that done with the registry deeds.
So it was already signed, it was lost?
Yeah, so the original got issued to the applicant, and in the midst of time, but it's been reported for registry deeds, so the board is sitting there saying, where's my certificate, It's lost, so now they want to record it.
1988.
That's an oldie. We had two certificate of compliance.
You were 6 years old?
Jesus.
It's funny, because I was 8 years old.
Wow, that's funny, because I had a son born 2 years before.
Okay, well, we've got a couple of certificate of compliances. Bob was able to go up to site inspections. The sites are stable. One of them for, what was it, Phipps?
Marsh Phillips.
There was an addition put on. It was just a little bit bigger, but it still was in the, what's that?
Phillips.
Yeah, it was like 15 years ago. So that,
Phillips,
yeah. Four Sterling Drive. So it was an addition onto an existing single family house. The addition was slightly bigger, but it was still outside the 50 foot. It's in the lawn area, so. It is what it is. And then the other one, 1480, the driveway got a lot smaller and further away from what they proposed. The site's stable, so pretty straightforward.
Okay, they would have a chance to review the numerous minutes that Jonathan.
What was never brought to our attention is we've always had a 90-day policy period for approving minutes from the day I was in. You know, the open meeting law gets revised over time. At some point, the Attorney General came in and said, well, because there is no date when you have to approve your minutes. And then I guess in one of the, the past couple of years ago, the Attorney General said, well, I recommend you do it at the next meeting. That was never conveyed to me. I was unaware, so, and I know it sort of came up because I think the town was going to warrant article to revise. So this is coming to the fore, so we're like, oh, okay, well, we weren't aware of these changes to the open meeting law. So we still had 90 days, and sometimes we weren't very good at 90 days either.
This is really 2016?
Yep. So we are now trying to catch up on some old stuff.
You just find these? I mean, that's kind of an odd list. You just find them on the side. When you look through, you see that.
We haven't attended. Minutes have always been the bane of our existence.
Yeah, I know.
It's like, but what do we do? Do we issue the permits we have to do within 21 days, or do we do the permits that we now just found out, the minutes at the next meeting? So we now have to make changes that's just come to our attention. But
we approved some minutes in this period of time.
And I'll tell you, before we turned into law, if you look at the dates of when the minutes were presented to the commission, when it was approved, we were basically doing them every other meeting because basically I did them. But then when we got reduced down, we lost all that administrative help. I basically had Anna for 20 hours a week before we turned into law. I don't even have her for 5.
Yeah.
Something had to slide. And guess what it was? It was minutes. Minutes went to the back burner because we still had to do all the customer service. We still had to do all the stuff that did have deadlines. We never missed a deadline that was written down. Right. And minutes still aren't written down. It's the Attorney General has a recommendation that we do it at the next meeting. And now, all right, so we've just learned that now, and we're trying to deal with it. So we're trying to catch up on all the old
stuff.
And
we did really, really good until the flood at town hall.
Yeah, so I think we would have more for you if we didn't.
So I look right over your desk.
Yeah, you've been in my, you know that massive 4-inch water main for the sprinkler system? Yeah, the gas going on that, it just showered.
Really?
Yeah, I lost my computer, lost my printer.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was on top of my desk. But my steel case with my drawers closed, that'll stay dry. All my financials, a lot of the stuff. I love my steel case. Those were awesome.
Yeah. Oh, wait, clean out your desk?
I did. Clean up the desk.
Really? Where did you go?
We're temporarily in the second floor of the fire department. I don't even have a phone yet.
It's cozy. Yeah, I'm sure he is.
Okay.
It's just a mess.
So moving ahead, if I have a motion, and we'll just run through these collectively. Motion for the approval of the minutes of January 25th, 2016, February 22nd, 2016, April 25th, 2016, May 9th, 2016, May 23rd, 2016, December 5th, 2016, January 23rd, 2017, and February 6th, 2017.
So moved.
And second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
And opposed? So Don, we get the second batch. That's 3 weeks.
Yeah, ago. I'll try and get it for the next meeting.
Okay.
Oh yeah. Well, the rest of February, we killed 2016, right?
Yeah, it's just great.
No?
Most of it.
Okay. There's a couple left. Okay, I'm sorry. And then we'll have the rest of 2017.
Okay, so two Michaels away. Is that your question?
Are you here for the
trial?
Did we do DPW yet? And did anyone show up?
Free Street? No.
What are you waiting for?
Number five?
Oh, I'm just listening.
Oh, okay.
Mr. Turnbull's running for the same way.
Oh, is that it?
So no one?
I told him.
So John was there?
He was leaving the building when I came in.
What do we miss, Don?
I'm just popping in DPW, 66B Fruit Street. They have an exemption request. They've already.
What's it for?
I thought he'd show up.
He was at the planning board meeting earlier.
He was what?
He was at the planning board meeting earlier.
Really?
He was around. But...
Well, I thought if he wouldn't show, he'd send VHB here.
What's the plan? VHB was?
Yeah, the VHB dude was here.
Yeah.
I just forgot.
Do you want to just...
Is this, obviously this is time critical?
I don't know what their timing is, but they missed the last meeting, so I figured they'd want to do it here.
What's it regarding?
Right there.
Yeah. Well, hopefully it'll open up. There we go. So, what's the reason this one's...
Oh, this is the water line.
So the water line, yeah, through to the existing wellhead, and they're trying to stay in the line, in within the existing gravel roadway. I think the only spot they were sort of going out is right through here, but that on the approved plan, here's the as-built for it. I hope this one opens up. This is freaking unbelievable. I don't know why it picks and chooses some and not others, but basically on this plan, it looked like there's a detention basin, right, Bob?
Yeah.
Yeah. And then there was a drain line to the bottom of it. So, but I think it's close enough where it shouldn't have negative impacts to the it was basically stormwater management for this gravel area would go into this low spot right here. So, yeah, the gravel, you know, because for it to be an exempt activity, the line should be within the existing roadway. The only section where I see it coming out is right here. But I don't think that's going to be much of an issue. You know, it's basically the shoulder of it. And then it's
so just... So it's the shoulder of the roadway?
It comes off, yeah, you know, like right here. Everything, the line is everywhere in within the shoulders of the roadway. The only part I see, it goes out. So this is the shoulder right here. You know, so that's all the gravel, like parking area right in here. But this area right here on the asphalt plan that won't open up on this laptop, this is really ticking me off tonight. There's basically a detention basin right through here. So I don't think it's going to have a negative impact on the detention basin. You know, they just basically, you know, put it in and put it back the way it should be. It should be fine.
How long is it?
Pretty long. Didn't come through, but they're getting outside our jurisdiction, and then I think you pop back into our jurisdiction when you get closer to Fruit Street.
they're coming right through here with it. And you've got Edge of Creek right here, so I don't think they're really showing the buffer zone here, but I assume all this, but it's all in the roadway, and it comes through here, through the roadway, you know, so.
So to Melissa's point, why are we going outside the shoulder and not in there?
Yeah, I mean, that was one thing I wanted to ask them, but they're not here.
They're removing the existing pipe? Right here? They're removing this?
Yeah, because I think it's undersized, and they're gonna replace it with a bigger one.
Yes.
Yeah, see, they're gonna remove the six and replace with an eight.
But the eight is that up there.
And then here, and then there's another line going into it. So there's existing pipes out of here that they're gonna replace, but they're also putting in new as well. So as far as I know, this is the new line that's gonna go in, and then this is the replacement line that is gonna get replaced.
So there's two lines.
Well.
Are there two lines? It appears there's two lines.
Because there's one line here, and then they're picking up a second, but I think what they're doing is, there's a reducer, you know, so there's existing infrastructure that they're tying into with this line, and then there's a whole new line coming in as well that's going to feed, I think, the one across the street. Because they want to blend the well water from that one into this one. So we'll table that.
Yes, table that.
Okay. And then.
And the Upper Charles Trail Committee is looking for a new rep from the commission. Anyone is so inclined to volunteer?
Ed said he wants to volunteer.
Was that you?
Ed.
Oh, Ed?
Yeah. I heard him say before he left.
He's up for that? You guys want to vote him in right now?
I nominate Ed.
We can do this.
I nominate Ed Carroll to be our liaison to the Upper Charles.
So we have new members coming up for it, right? Potentially we'll go.
Hopefully it'll be nice.
Yeah. Your neighbor or?
It's actually his neighbor, my teammate, Karen. I forgot.
So is she confirmed by the
slide? I don't think so, because they want it. That was a while ago, I was like,
right
on it.
They were
supposed to
invite
her to.
Yeah, she'd
have
to fill
out a hug
application.
She filled
it out. She'd have to get it. Okay. Yeah. Got a hug if you want to.
Well, they just accepted Chris's resignation just, a couple weeks ago.
Right. And so, remember, it'll only be good until June 30th. And then they have to do it, so they may be waiting until July so they don't have to do it twice.
Yeah, so they have to do it twice. Because they'd have to do the whole process all over again.
The application and then send an email to me. Work.
Yeah, that makes sense. I mean, then they'd have to reappoint her all over again in June, so they probably want to let you guys just ride for six until the next term.
I guess we should really rather disappointing.
So if you have to fill out a hug, you got to make sure the recipient is okay with the hug. Can't give somebody a hug.
Exactly.
We had national hug dates. We had national hug dates.
No, number nine. It was just big. Michael's way. There was one dead tree that I could deal with. There was this one live tree. Right here, basically very close to the house within striking distance that they were hoping to have removed. And I said typically, and it was just beyond, just within the PIB, so it's within the limit of work. And then I was like, well, if you guys typically would look for something smaller, she had room even outside the PIB. You know, in the natural area, put in a natural, tree or shrub if you guys were amenable to that. One of the other things I wanted to just point out.
So she was on to that?
Yep. Yeah.
dead tree, but there was a small compost area, like, here's the stones for the PIV right here. So just over the edge, there was a little compost bin, and it seemed pretty benign, you know. You could ask her to take it out and put it on the lawn somewhere.
It doesn't seem to be being used, does it?
There's a small amount right in here that's composted down, so yeah, it's probably pretty old, you know. If you just...
So they don't use it, they can take it out?
Yeah, I just asked her, don't use it, take it out.
Okay.
Take it out.
Yeah, yeah.
If you use it, just, you don't want to get it.
Yeah, all right, that sounds good. And what I also wanted to point out was, yeah, coming out of the house, it's just got two lines, one here, basically, you've got a line going to here and then further out into the wetland. So I didn't know if the commission would want to just have the line go. Typically, you want it to go, like, there's the PID right there, you know. So typically, you guys, and to here would be about 10 feet, you know. So would you want to just see them not have it extend so far into the buffer zone that close to the wetland? So that's what I mentioned. I go, because the current owner said these were here when we bought the place, you know. So I was saying the commission might want to just have it cut off here, because it would still be 10 feet away from your house, you know. And,
yeah, they would just recycle back into the basement.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah.
If you want, I could tell them, you know, just have it kind of cut off after the PIV. All right. So if you guys were okay with that, I will write out a letter to them.
All right, then I will not be here June 26th.
We lost our little book.
I'll shoot you that letter.
Yeah, I'm not
going to
be here June 26th
either.
Okay. What's going on? Is that the school?
Not until the
27th.
They moved it.
So, I'm sorry, Jeff, that was June 12th, you said?
26th.
26th?
Wait, you know, the last day of school.
Anyone else out for June 26th?
Well, it's about me.
Wow, so that would be four. That would be never.
So, we still have four.
Still have four.
Four.
As long as no one else.
When's the last day of school?
Sorry, I think it's actually the 21st. Yeah, I was thinking a week later.
Yeah.
They end 3 days. Yeah. Yeah.
That would be the last meeting of the term. You know, you get a new term in July.
Okay.
So hopefully we'll be getting closer to getting a new member, hopefully in July. I'm sorry, I didn't hear
the question. Will we have to just be re-sworn in or something?
Yeah.
That's every year.
Every three.
I just
yeah, you gotta get reappointed. The term's good for 3 years, but staggered, so not all seven are up at the same time.
Right.
And then you ask if you want to get reappointed, and then they go from there.
Yeah. I just go to town clerk and just swear for whatever. But it's like court. So I just go. Hey, swear me.
Yeah. The selectman will send you a letter saying you've been reappointed. Go to the town clerk and get sworn in. Letter, they go through that.
So, we do everything?
We do burden, huh? There's one application.
So, the process for the
yeah, the two new applications were on for the agenda.
Yeah. So, Don, a letter to the planning board.
That's just a draft. Yeah, it was like talking.
So, we can like give you comments? Or response. We still discuss it, or is it?
Yeah, that's what, like, I was like putting the date in question, you know, because they didn't give us a deadline. But that's what, those were just the original comments we were thinking. I mean, in essence, we were thinking the individual members might have feedback, but technically as a body, you guys can't come up with a final determination, you know? You know, so anything you say, like everything you said is like, well, it's, you know, it's just projection, you know?
But I mean, so they're ultimately going to decide how many lots and what the conventional subdivision can look like. They're going to decide that. So the plan that they put in front of us
have a three plan.
Yeah, but I guess what they're trying to drive at is if you guys thought it might, you know, that might be a good conventional, you know, like I said, you can't approve it, but, you know, they were trying to say, well, you can approve, condition, or deny, you know, and go either way, but if you're going to think it might be approvable, then they could say, okay, then that concept, because they can't start looking at the open space plan until they have a concept plan that is approvable, you know? So,
approvable.
Right.
So they're never going to come in front of us with this plan.
No, exactly. Yeah. So exactly. So you would never see that. Well, yeah. But then it would be an alternative. So when they came in with the open space plan, you guys said, "Well, where are your alternatives?" Because you're basically not meeting. You know, you're asking for a variance. So one of the alternatives would be, well, here's the concept. Here's the concept plan that you never saw.
Yeah, but that doesn't seem right. I mean,
that's what I'm saying. That
doesn't seem right. It seems like we should be able to say, like, where's the alternative to this?
Right, exactly.
So if they came before us.
No, yeah, so.
Based on this.
So yeah, that's all maxed out. Yeah.
They have to approve this and say, yes, this is approvable, you can build this many lots. And then they go to open space plan and they configure the open space plan based on the lots. And you said they can build here. So if we decide that, no, we wouldn't approve this, we wouldn't approve this, then that mixes like five lots and they can't create the open space plan those five, you know, the total number, right?
I'm pretty
sure that's the
right.
So I don't see why.
That's why I'm saying, like, everything I was writing is like, you're asking us a question that we can't answer.
Yeah, right.
You know what I mean? Right. Until you know, so I mean,
right. So when we look at the cumulative effect and the impacts, we can still, you know, if they have a proposed lot that's within our jurisdiction, we can deny it. Because each single family home lot that's in our jurisdiction has to come before us.
Yeah, because I mean, and that's where I was sort of getting to the point too. They're asking about the road, but it also shows all the lots, and under the commission, it's like, well, we wouldn't do it all in one look. We would, you'd have to apply for the road, and we're either going to go like this or this. And I remember one of the first times I was on, I remember when the commission said, okay, look, we just approved your road. We didn't approve all your lots. Don't come back to us when you start asking for these lots, and if we deny them, don't say, well, why did you ever allow us to build a road if we couldn't, you know, build a house? Because we don't want to hear that, you know, because it's basically, it's two different things, you know? So.
But I feel like
they're. But we've done it many times, approve the road. And then they come back with individual lots.
It's not like numbers. But I guess what I'm saying is they come in. The commission didn't want to hear, well, wait a minute, you know, we showed you we want to do 30 lots. Why aren't you approving 30 lots? How come you're only approving 28 and you're denying two? And they say, well, we don't want to hear that because we weren't approving 30 lots when we approved the road. You know? We approved the road. We didn't approve 30 lots in the road.
Well, then, so then when it goes, so if they pick one of these open space plans, you have the one, you know, with the two cul-de-sacs.
Right.
And you have the other one that goes straight across.
Yeah, but and then the third one that didn't have anything, you know, because as we said.
The one with the cul-de-sacs.
Yeah, we said, as you went along, it got, you know, it got less and less disturbance here.
Right.
This one is saying, well, this is something the planning board can't approve, you know, or.
Right, because
current. Yeah, they won't do that.
Okay.
But then it goes to the in the bylaw. It says, well, when an application comes in to the commission as an alternative, they should be. It says the commission can ask them to go to planning board and zoning board and ask for variances, putting it back on them. You know, so that's what I'm saying.
Why has the planning board ever asked us to do this?
No, I've never seen this. This is the first time I've ever seen anything like this.
So
we used to have the joint meetings though.
Remember? Yeah, you have joint meetings. Yeah, you know.
But it was the same situation.
But when you had joint meetings, you had applications.
Yeah, right.
You know what I mean? You had a joint meeting because someone submitted an application, and then we figured because someone has submitted applications all at the same time, so you guys said, well, why don't we have an initial joint meeting to talk about the big picture? But you can't have a joint. You can't have a joint meeting on this because no one's applying to you guys on this.
You might have all fired up.
I'm sorry.
So with Legacy Farms, when we did the joint meeting for that, you know, those proposals, they had the application already submitted. But that was informal.
Yeah. Well, there might have been like a, there might have been an informal, like, a lot of times we have like tabletops, and you might have like, you know, like one member, not a quorum, come in informally, but when we had those joint meetings, we had joint meetings because we had applications, and I'm pretty sure Legacy Farms filed at the same time with both boards.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Question in the audience.
Hi. Gary Trendle, 31 Chamberlain Street. So when you guys say that that plan is approvable, what exactly is approvable, and how do you know it's approvable without having more details on it?
Well, the way they were saying, could you approve, the commission was saying, we could approve it, we could condition it, we could deny it. You know?
So they just want to be,
can you approve it? Would it be approvable?
But I think it goes back to the other thing. There's some stuff that, I mean, we're taking it for granted that that's against the bylaws and wetlands protection. Like, you couldn't just put the road right through the vernal pool. They didn't even have that. But there's certain things. So whether it's approval or not is whether or not the bylaw or the Wetlands Protection Act explicitly says you cannot do this. But there's quite a bit that says at the discretion of the Conservation Commission to meet the intent of blah, blah, blah. And that's where it goes into that yes. Like, and
yeah.
Scott likes to put it out all the time. Scott Goddard likes to put out where he can get waivers from.
Right.
But that's still at the discretion of the board. So
right.
Yes, the bylaws allow you, it says you could permit it if blank, blank, blank. And a lot of times we'll ask for,
mitigation
and everything, like an open space plan, so we could, but there's so many other factors.
So
there's
so many that are dead. If they came in with something like this, the commission might not, like you were saying, they might not like this road, but they might like this road, you know? So it might change over time through the application process, you know?
So the answer that we provided them was, you know, it's feasible that it could be approved, but it's a low probability.
Yeah. For the concept one, yeah. Because the commission's always looking for, well, if you have alternatives that has less disturbance to the resource areas, why won't you do that, you know? And then I think they would be coming back saying, well, this is the one that has the least amount of disturbance because it's just extending the cul-de-sacs. And then the commission would say, we like this one, so go to the planning board and see if they'll give it to you. And then if they go to the planning board and they show, here's our denial, they won't give it to us, so now that's their, well, we can't do this,
because
we were denied.
We tried.
The commission has the ability to ask them, go to the planning board and get a denial. Go to the zoning board and get a denial.
Well, that's
so
right.
Now we know you have a denial, so now you have to, you know, instead of this one, you're going with this one, you know? So.
Well, but I mean, even between the two plans, so the one with the crossing with the bridge for the emergency access, like the first thing I would say if I was comparing the two is why don't you have a bridge on the other one? If you can build a bridge here and have less impact because you're building a bridge, then why aren't you building a bridge
on
this one?
On this
so you're
one,
not
exactly.
Comparing apples to apples. Like,
yeah,
this
no,
says,
exactly.
You're having a lot more disturbance. It makes it look, the other one look better, but you're not looking at it. You put a bridge there.
Right, so then you guys would be, that's where the square dance would happen once the application gets in.
But if the planning board approves this one,
or,
you know, this one for the open space plan, then we never look back at,
because I assume once, if they have, and that's, I think what they're trying to get at, I don't think they like the conventional either, you know? But for them to move on to the open space, it has to show that a conventional could pass. So it's almost like they're just like, I think they just want to hear, well, is it feasible? Great. Because if we have a feasible plan, we're never going to see it. We're just going to move on to the open space plan.
Well, I think they want this one to pass because they can build more lots. But if we say no, we're going to approve this over here, you only have this many lots, and I think that's what we were trying to get at, is saying,
look, we're not even going to, you know, look at this, the lots, because we're just going to look at the road. You're even asking us if the road is okay. You're not asking us about how many lots, because those are all different filings too, you know, so it just shows how complex.
It gives them potentially more access to lots, but that doesn't mean it's going to get approved.
They got to get approved.
No, but I mean, doesn't this plan, so this plan says they can have
they can build 35 lots based on this plan.
Is that the wood convention?
So then, like, it's really up to us.
Yeah, why not?
You're gonna just.
Well, we're only supposed to be until like 10.
If this gets approved, and they just say yes, they can build this. It's buildable.
You can't say that, it's feasible.
It's feasible, not us, but the planning, if the planning board says it's okay.
Right.
This is only conventional, then they say open 35 lots down the middle are open space concept. So you can take those 35 lots and you can.
Is the same number?
You can make them smaller, you fit them here.
Right.
And you leave this an open space, so you have 35. And if you went back here and you said, and the planning board said, no, this isn't approvable, we can't approve this, you can't put this road here, you can build this. So now you don't have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So now you only have 30 lots.
Right.
So now you go over here to your open space plan, so now you can only put 30 lots here.
Right.
So isn't that how it works? I think the open space, doesn't open space plan show 38 lots?
35. The open space shows 34. The conventional shows 35.
So they reduced it by now.
Yeah, but I was under the impression that that's what the process is.
But it's still planning board's responsibility to say that.
Yeah,
right,
I know, it's almost like.
They're asking
you guys, they're asking you for a final determination on something that hasn't even been submitted. So to me, you shouldn't be. Can't answer that question as a board.
It's still their jurisdiction.
It's still,
hypothetically.
But the planning board won't, they're not going to assess this unless they know that it's approvable by the CONCOM. Because that's what they're, I know the planning board was looking for guidance from CONCOM before they proceeded with this, as to what, is this even doable?
But they know, they're an issuing authority, and so is the CONCOM. The CONCOM's an issuing authority under state and town law. How can they prejudge something and say, oh, yeah, we'll approve that when it comes in?
So doesn't that mean that you can submit a more formalized application for you to?
That's what we're, they have to submit an application for the commission to make a definitive answer.
But that would be like if somebody came to us first and said, and then we go to plan, would you approve these setbacks before they submit something to?
That's what I was saying. You can't say, you have to, you can't have a definitive. They would ask us for a definitive. Yeah, the questions were, would this be approvable? To me, I'm like, you can't answer that question as a body.
So my answer, so Mr. Mascherini doesn't want to go through the effort of the engineering study unless he knows that it's feasible in some
way. Yeah, because he'd have to put a lot of engineering money into something that he doesn't want to pursue. He wants to pursue the open space plan. He wants to put all the engineering into that.
Is the conventional plan just sort of a red herring?
I'm sorry, what?
Open space? It's not a matter of spending the money, it's a matter of knowing what the maximum is. If it's 38, it's 38. Planning board accepts that. Then they can design the 38 with their open space plan. It doesn't mean you approve 38.
Correct.
That just gives out a number.
Rebuilt.
Right. But now you're going to put everything tight and make it work out.
Yeah.
So can I just ask?
You've done this before, right?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I've reviewed stuff before,
So can I just ask, though, so I'm just trying, and I apologize, that I was at the planning board earlier, so I missed the discussion on this, but, and I can take this offline, I know it's almost 10 o'clock, so that's what I'm trying to figure out, and my neighbors have all been asking me, like, what does this mean coming up CONCOM, and I don't really know what to tell them what the next steps are. I mean, even my conversation with Mr. Weissmantel after the meeting, I told him that it was not likely but feasible, and I said, what does that mean? He said, I don't know. So
that's what Jeff said too. He goes,
What are the next steps here?
You don't know until there's a formal proposal and everyone weighs in on it.
Okay.
And that's the chicken and the egg.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Okay.
So you're asking us, based on just looking at a plan, not reviewing any engineering studies, not reviewing what the impacts are to the wetlands, not looking at cumulative impacts. Here's a plan. Does this look like something that the commission could potentially approve? It is feasible. It could get approved. But
what is it?
Four wetland right. Crossings.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So let me ask you.
Impact
so we even know.
Yeah. know, it was probably.
Like a big deal, yeah. Like if they try to put in the pipe like they talked about in Chamberlain, that wouldn't get approved because that would, like these crossings would have to meet the Massachusetts stream crossing standards, which needs a bridge. And so, sometimes it's cost prohibitive.
So even on the open space plan.
So yeah, it's like someone going to the board and saying, "Can you put a skyscraper there?" Right? You're looking at it, you're like, you know,
possible.
It's possible. You know, you could, but there's a lot of engineering studies that need to be done. So first, support the foundation. You know?
So do you guys have any idea or guidance as to what the wetland impact is of this crossing right here, like square footage wise?
Only what they told us.
Which was 4,500. So I guess what I'm struggling with is that my understanding is that you look at the cumulative wetland impact across the entire parcel, correct? So this one is 4,500 square feet. This one is something, albeit small. And he's got something substantial over at the use. That's well over 5,000 square feet of wetland impact. No?
Yeah, so then that would be former standards under one section of the Act. Then there's also the limited project where you wouldn't have the 5,000 foot standard.
So basically,
for the roadway, for the crossing. But then it's discretionary.
You could propose it. You know, it'd be at the discretion if it was within a reason. You know, if it was 5,000, 50. That's close, then
yeah.
You know, we can use our judgment and discretion in those situations. If it's something significantly more than that, it gets raised to the level of the Massachusetts Environmental Policy Act, and has to go through a formal, you know, this new environmental impact study, put a report together, and it goes through a higher level of review at the state. Significantly more expensive to do that. I think the Army Corps of Engineers gets involved in the evaluation.
So 4,500 square feet plus something substantial over the use.
762.
Is inherently well over, as the plan is currently submitted, is well over 5,000 square feet.
It's a limited project, too, that doesn't count towards the 5,000.
It does. So the limited project
can go over the 5,000.
Yeah, it's 5,000. You know, it can go over.
What does that mean, limited project?
It's just the
transportation. There's limited projects that you can have wetland disturbance condition, like with wetland replication.
Okay.
But basically, roadway falls under a limited project. And then normally the 5,000 is when you deal with like a single family house and you're going to put a driveway in, typically would have to keep it under 5,000 for that.
Right. My point was that the way you lay out the roads can determine how many crosses you can have on lots. You know, if you have a parallel road in the stream and 8 lots off the road, well, then you have to cross the stream 8 times. That's what that chart is saying. You can't do. Is that feasible or not? It's possible, but not likely.
Right.
I think the people over here are more afraid of saying, yes, it could do 50
miles. Sounds great. Do it.
Yeah, you weren't saying it, you know, but that's our concept.
Well, what Mr. Mastriani is going to do is they're going to come back to the planning board on May 8th and say, well, CONCOM says it's feasible, so now we can proceed through the planning board here.
Well, did we actually say it's feasible?
They are feasible. Okay. Mastriani sat outside. He said, oh, it's feasible. We're good. We're rolling.
And then they'll come back to us and we'll say, so what are the alternatives? Why are you doing this?
Nothing categorical.
Okay. So is it fair to say that nothing was really decided or evaluated tonight?
Oh, yeah.
Until you have an actual application, and then that will be.
Yeah, it was feasible. It could get approved. It's feasible. It could get denied. Well, I think the way you said it is like, yeah, you know, it might.
How did you say?
It says feasible in the.
But it says my.
Subdivision plan is very low probability.
Yeah.
You know, we have a track record on this commission of pushing back on developers to minimize the amount of wetland alteration, buffer zone alteration.
So with regards to the roadway there, his opportunities to decrease the impact would be bridge? Or like what are the options there? For a road, he's already crossing at the narrowest part of the stream. So
we'd have to meet the stream crossing standards, you know, so it's either culvert size big enough or bridge. There's one at coming off the end of the road.
So probably not on the side, right?
No, but there's an intermittent stream right there. You know, the other ones would be.
But at the end of the day, next time we'll come back to you, it'll be the open space, it won't be the conventional.
Right.
But even if they come back to us with 30 feet, saying they can do 30 feet lots, we don't necessarily approve 30 lots.
Yeah, but we don't know that until they submit individual.
Right.
So, as a Chamberlain Street and Wayland Road, we're more concerned with the connection of Chamberlain Street and Wayland than we are the number of lots. But that's why we're more sensitive about the actual road itself. I think we all expect the number of lots to get cut down some, but it's that connection that we're trying to hopefully do. So that's where I'm just trying to understand sort of. You know, basically, sounds like you got the.
It sounds like you got nothing. You wanted to hear.
He heard what he wanted to hear, and the planning board will go on, and now he's going to do the engineering study and do his full application, and then it's going to come back to CONCOM, and then you guys will.
We don't have any jurisdiction over whether the road is connected or cul-de-sac, so all we do is look at the impacts to the resource areas.
Yeah. So tell me this, is it feasible that he would actually go back to the planning board and do a full engineering. It's a full evaluation and application. Then it comes back to CONCOM, and you guys could feasibly look at it and say, no, connecting these two roads is too big of a resource area impact. You can't do it.
Yeah.
All right. So we're done for neural than we were.
Great.
But we. This is the planning board actually delayed because of this, and it doesn't seem like.
Well, that was the point. It's chicken, it's a chicken and the egg. They come into us, we're telling them we can't make a final decision or give you, a determination on an application for unless we get the study.
That makes complete sense. Because that's what I'm looking at. Like, how do you even establish feasibility or potential for approval without having
the comment was, is this something that could be submitted?
That makes sense.
Schools. How do we get this up here?
That's what I said. The middle school one? Yeah, what's happening? This is a high school auditorium. Do they even put like it gets prettier.
Well, I think because they said we don't need two big auditoriums.